Welcome back to the September 29 video, and today we're going to move into section 11.4, which is tangent planes and linear approximation. And what today is about, this is the multivariable version of when you studied tangent lines and linear approximation back in Calculus 1. So we will be doing the two-dimensional version of tangent lines, which are called tangent planes. So our goal for the end of today, we should be able to find the equation of the plane tangent to a function at a given point. We should be able to calculate the linear approximation to a multivariable function, and we should be able to use the linear approximation to estimate the function's output, just as we did in Calc 1. All right, now let's just get a conceptual understanding of what the tangent plane looks like. You know, over here on the side, let me draw a little thought bubble. Back here in Calculus 1, we had some function, and we had some given point, which was determined by the value of x, which was, let's say, a. The tangent line was a line that just sort of grazed that curve. It met the curve at that point, they coincided here, and their slopes were the same. The slope in the x direction of this graph was the same for the original function, and it was the same for the tangent line. And so if you took any point that was relatively close to A, and you plugged it into the equation for the tangent line, then you could get a pretty good estimate for the function's actual value. And in Calc 3, you took this to even new heights. You know, you found not just the linear approximation, but you found the Taylor series, which was not a line, but was a parabola or a cubic function or a quartic function, which approximated the curve much better than the line did. So in this case, we have our function f of x, y, a function of two variables, and someone gives us a point which is equal to a comma b. So I have to give you both an x and a y to specify the point. Instead of a line, we come up with a flat sheet, which once again touches the graph that we are given for the function that we have, and roughly speaking, has the same slope or slant as our function's graph does. So if I look in the x direction, the slope in the x direction should closely match the slope of the function, and the slope in the y direction should match the slope of the function. Now, let's establish the formula for the tangent plane. The plane tangent to the graph of f of xy at some specified point, let's call it x naught, y naught, has the equation z equals z naught. So the output that I get by plugging the given point into the function, plus take the derivative in the x direction at the given point and multiply it by the difference between x and x naught. Take the derivative in the y direction at the given point, multiply that by y minus y naught. Now compare that with the one variable tangent line equation, which was y equals f at a plus f prime at a, x minus a. Here, we have the output variable y, and in ours, we have the output variable z. The first quantity that we get is just the output at the given point, z naught, f of a. Then we start to add terms to make sure that the slopes and the slants match up. In the one variable case, we only had that one derivative to think about. F prime, the derivative in the x direction, times x minus the given point. Here we have two directions, two derivatives to account for. The derivative in the x direction times x minus the given x, and the derivative in the y direction, y minus the given y. Okay, so it's exactly like this tangent line equation in the case of a single variable, except we just have an extra term to account for the fact that we have two derivatives instead of one. Now let's do an example here. Oh, not quite yet, almost there. One more definition. Now, recall from calculus one that the tangent line equation was exactly the same as the equation for the linear approximation to a function. Those were the same thing, they were synonymous. Because this tangent line, well, it is a linear function because it has just x to the first power. And in addition to that, it does a good job of approximating the function's output values. Now, just as in the single variable case, our tangent plane is also referred to, is also called the linear approximation to f of x, lowercase f of xy at the point x naught, y naught. All of the variables in the tangent plane equation have exponent 1, z to the first power, x to the first power, y to the first power. So this is a linear equation with two variables, and it can be used to approximate the function's output at points that are near the given point. So let's try it with the following equation. Find the equation of the tangent plane to f of xy equals sine of x minus y at the point 0, 0. Then use this as your linear approximation to estimate the value of f at 0.01, comma, negative 0.01. All right, so step one is we need to collect all the data that we need to fill in the blanks of the tangent plane equation, which means we're going to need z naught, which is equal to f of x naught, y naught, which is equal to f of the given point, 0, 0. We're also going to need the value of the first derivative in the x direction at the point f of x, at the point x naught, y naught, which is 0, 0. Finally, we're going to need f sub y at x naught, y naught. We're going to need f sub y at 0, 0. All right. So z naught, which comes from plugging 0, 0 into the original function, seems like the easiest one to get so far, because it doesn't require any derivatives. So let's calculate sine of 0 minus 0. Sine of 0 is 0 again, so we get sine of 0. All right, next we need to get f sub x with 0, 0 plugged in. So getting f sub x, we need to take the derivative with respect to x of our given function, pretending that y is constant. Now we have an outer function of sine whose derivative is cosine. And then we multiply by the derivative of the inner function. And since y is constant, it vanishes. The derivative with respect to x is simply 1, and we get cosine x minus y. If we plug in our given point 0, 0, we get cosine of 0, which is 1. Okay, now for f of f sub y, using chain rule again, we have cosine of x minus y, derivative of the outer function. And then we take the derivative with respect to y of the inner function. Now, x vanishes, it's constant, and the derivative of negative y becomes negative 1. plug in 0, 0. And we have negative cosine 0 minus 0 equals -1. So here are our key pieces. We have z naught, which is nothing. We have f sub x, which is 1. We have f sub y, which is -1. Okay, I'm running short on space. Now let's go ahead and fill in the blanks of our tangent plane equation. Z equals z naught, which was 0, plus f sub x with the point plugged in, which is 1, times x minus the x of our given point, plus f sub y at 0, 0, y minus the y of our given point. And after we plug everything in, simplify, we get that the equation of the tangent plane is that z is equal to x minus y. Now, some of you may have already anticipated that was going to happen. If you spend a lot of time studying physics already, you're probably pretty familiar with the law of small angles, which says that if the input of sine is very small, then you can essentially just take the sine off and get almost the exact same value with the sine on as with the sine off. And so here, since x minus y is going to be very small, close to 0, 0, the physics law of small angles says you can pretty much just remove that sine and get a pretty good estimation to what you had before. So at the point 0.01, -0.01, let's estimate the function's value at that point as specified in the last part of the problem. And if I plug that in for x and y, the output will be approximately equal to 0.02, would be the estimate. So all in all, here is the equation of the tangent plane, which is used to approximate. And here's the approximation given at this particular point near 0, 0. That is what the tangent plane is all about. Very similar to the tangent line calculations of calculus 1, except we have one more derivative to think about.